So we're going to continue this morning session. This will be the last talk. The speaker is Josef Šilhan from Masaryk University, and he'll talk about variational approach to conformal curves.
Okay, so thank you for the introduction once more. As you can see, the title of this talk is very similar to the previous one, and indeed the topic is almost the same. We worked independently on the same thing in the same time, but you will see that it's joint work with Vojtěch Žádník from Masaryk University, is rather different. And actually, it will go back to the first lecture today by Rutgauer. I will use tractors intensively the whole talk. This is the motivation. So first I review something what everybody knows in the Euclidean, the curves in the Euclidean case. Then I will start with basic theory of conformal curves. And actually, the functional, which where we can look for critical curves, or the one functional, there are more such conformal invariant functionals. They will just appear naturally in the general study of invariant calculus for conformal curves. This functional, which I denote here by alpha, it's essentially what Vojtěch talked about in the previous talk. So it will be the variational approach, and then the last step, we look at the second variation of this functional. Okay, here, this is something what everybody knows. These are Frenet formulae in the Euclidean case. This basically is an introduction of what motivates us. So what we know in the Euclidean case and what we would like to have in the conformal case. So first we a priori deal with parameterized curves. So we have some parametrization, which gives us a tangent vector along the curve. In the Euclidean case, we can differentiate along the curve, like this is this expression, which I will denote by this comma. And if we have the orthonormal Frenet frame. We have curvatures, torsions, kappa one, kappa two, and so on. We have preferred parametrization, which is actually used here. It's the parametrization where the tangent vector u has the length one. And the basic functional in the Euclidean geometry is here. It is written as the energy or the length as one wish. And critical curves for such a functional, it's of course geodesics. Okay, so this is the Euclidean case. I mean, the Riemannian case is essentially the same. In the conformal setting, I will go. This is the whole slide. So here I can go quickly because we heard about it in several talks today. This is my conformal manifold class of metrics. We have the density bundles exactly as Rod introduced yesterday and used today. We have the conformal metric, which is density valued object. So we can raise and lower indices. Levi-Civita connection for two different metrics, G and G hat. Transforms as you can see here, it's just some formula where this epsilon is given by conformal rescaling. You can forget these technical details. It's just to tell you what technicalities are behind it, but not really something what I would extensively use. Okay. One thing, if we study the curves in a conformal geometry, first question, if we are motivated by Euclidean case, what is the conformal arc length if there is any? Actually, there is. We shall come to that soon. But concerning the restriction to parametrization, there is more than that. And another problem is how to whether we have conformally invariant differentiation along the curve, because remember that Levi-Civita connection transforms in a complicated way, so it's not the right way to differentiate along the curve in the conformal setting. Actually, here I should emphasize that the theory of conformal curves is old object, and it was studied in detail by Fialkov in 40s, who actually found a Frenet construction in terms of vectors, of course not tractors in that time, but it's rather complicated. He of course found also the conformal arc length, but his construction is, I mean, Fialkov is often cited, but I guess nobody really reads him because it's really, it takes time to get into his work. And we won't need it. Okay. The notation I will use is the mainly this small u in the bottom. So if we start with a curve, with a given with parameterized curve, this is the capital U is tangent vector, and we have this object which is sort of the length, but it's density valued, of course. Okay. Now is the list of literature which motivates us. The first one is Fialkov. I already commented upon that. Then there is a work of Bailey Eastwood, where they observed existence of certain functional, but in their article, it's exactly the Bailey Eastwood functional Wojtek talked about. But in this article, it was rather observed that there is something like this, not really, they didn't really study critical curves. In this Bailey Eastwood go over its introduction of tractor calculus. And finally, I would like to point out to Emilio Musso, Professor Musso, because he also introduced or initiated the study of certain conformal invariant functional, which is different from the functional me or Wojtek talked about. And actually the group around Professor Musso is almost completely disjoint with the conformal geometry group we meet. But actually in what I present here, this conformally conformal arc length functional can be put into the same footing as the functional me or Wojtek talked about. So it's really in the same family, and it can be studied in using the same technique. This is the basic tractor calculus, only this slide. The tractor bundle is the triple alpha mu tau. It's exactly the triple you saw in the first talk today. So I won't go into details. We have the tractor metric, we have the tractor connection. It is conformally invariant, but to say what really conformal invariance means requires some additional technicalities which are skipped here. Anyway, we shall build tractor Frenet frame, which tells us immediately that what is the right invariant differentiation along the curve, because the tractor connection is invariant. Okay, to build tractor Frenet frame, we simply start with tractor, which I denote here by T. We have this norm of the vector, which is density valued. That's the right way to put to the bottom of the tractor. That's conformal invariant. And now we can differentiate T as many times as we want. U is the first derivative of T, U prime the second derivative, and we can continue as long as we want. But that's basically what we need to build tractor Frenet frame, because now we have these tractors T, U, U prime, U2 prime, and so on. Generically, this will be a basis of the tractor bundle along the curve. Now we can orthonormalize Font Frenet formulae, and this gives us the right conformal curvature, torsion, and so on. Similarly, like in the Euclidean case for curves. So once we have this bunch of tractors, we can orthonormalize, build Frenet construction, and so on. So we know exactly what to do to build theory of conformal curves. I won't go into these details, but that's when we initiate this process, we know what to do if we want conformal theory of curves. If we want to go to conformal invariants, we shall need Gram matrices. So if we have these several tractors along the curve, the derived tractors along the curve, we can take Gram matrix. In this case, in what is displayed below, it's the Gram matrix of first four tractors. Of course, we can take more and so on, and continue in this. This alpha beta here, alpha is the product of tractor U prime, beta of U2 primes. By the way, these bold symbols always denote tractor fields. Usual symbols don't denote tensor fields. If you look at the Gram matrix, the zeros and ones or minus ones, it's sort of direct computation, and we can see that the first non-trivial object is this alpha, which is the u prime dot u prime, and that's the simplest conformal invariant of parameterized curves. Of course, we have also the dependence on the parameterization, so we can ask if we reparameterize what happens, and this alpha or beta here, they depend heavily on the reparametrization. But go to the next slide. they tell us about the parameterization. First thing is to observe that if we reparameterize, that this is the alpha after the tilde denotes reparameterization. So if we reparameterize this object, it changes by the Schwarzian. So it tells us that if we can require this to be zero, and this is preferred class of projective parameters. Moreover, if we take determinant of Gram matrix, then it's just linear algebra to tell us that the reparameterization is extremely simple. So if we take this delta I is the determinant of Gram matrices. Here we have first four vectors. This is indicated by this small I. We can take bigger Gram matrix. And the linear algebra tells us that if G is the reparameterization, it's here on the top. This determinant depends on the parameterization in very simple way, in exactly this way. So we can require this determinant or any of these to be equal to one or plus minus one. And that's exactly, if we take the simplest non-trivial determinant, which is not delta three, that would be just one or minus one. But if we take delta four and require this to be one, plus one or minus one, depending on the sign, this tells us, or this gives us preferred parameterization, which is exactly the conformal arc length, which Musso and others studied. One can actually show that this delta four is non-negative, so we have this conformal arc length. Now, I didn't talk about conformal circles so far, so one possibility how to introduce them is just the condition that delta four is zero. Then we have no conformal arc length, of course, because we can normalize it to one only if this is positive. But the degenerate case, well, the delta four is zero, it's just it's the condition for conformal geodesics. Okay, if we want to build the theory of conformal curves, the degenerate case is conformal geodesics. Otherwise, we have the preferred parameter, conformal arc length, and we can use the Gram-Schmidt orthogonalization process and so on. And in the Frenet formulae, we obtain absolute invariant conformal curvature, conformal torsion. I will come to that a bit later, but I won't go into details now. So what about the variation? As I observed here, the simplest object, conformal invariant object is this alpha, which is conformal analog of the energy along the curve. So it's a natural question to look at this and ask for variation of this object. So, well, we have this alpha, beta, gamma, and so on. We essentially focus on the first one. So this is already stated before. We can write explicitly what this alpha is. It's, well, expression like this. U is the tangent vector, U prime is the acceleration, U2 prime is a jerk. Then there is some curvature term, P is the Schouten tensor as in the previous talk. As you can see, it's of the third order in the parameterization, so the tangent vector is of the first order. It's conformal invariant, so it's a good candidate to look at. One can observe exactly as in the previous talk that difference between Bailey-Eastwood functional and this invariant functional alpha is in the term which this is the exact term, it's just the differential along the in the tangent direction. So if we take if we integrate alpha, then this term after integration, it will give only boundary terms. So both alpha and both this left hand side, which is Bailey-Eastwood functional, will have the same family of critical curves. Okay, now the setup for variation. This will be formulated in slightly different way than in the previous talk. For simplicity, I simply fix endpoints of the curve and tangent vectors at endpoints. Then I have this functional. This is my alpha, the conformal energy along the curve. Then I need variational vector field. In this setup of variation, if I fix endpoints and tangent vectors, I will need the variational vector field to vanish to the first order at the endpoints. Xi is x1, x2 are endpoints. And of course, this variational vector field it corresponds to the transversal coordinate. So we can assume that it commutes with u. U originally was the tangent vector on the curve. So we extend, we consider some family of curves. Therefore, we extend the tangent vector along the curve to, let's say, tangent vector in some neighborhood. That is the variational vector field, and they commute. In the computation in the on next slides, it will be useful to consider a tractor object built from Z, and I will refer to this bold Z as variational tractor field. This is just direct computation. It appears from the computation that this is a natural object to give it a name and work with that as sort of basic building block in the conformal variation. So we want to take variation of this, so variation of alpha. So by this nabla z, we need to hit u prime, and just commuting covariant derivatives, we can replace differential with respect to z and differential with respect to u, differentiation with respect to u, modulo some curvature term. Omega is the curvature of the tractor connection, which I didn't mention. So this omega is just some curvature terms. This two is here because we simply have two objects to differentiate. So we have this expression. So this is just direct computation. It turns out that it's convenient to this first summand. I will replace here by there are some other tractors. This U3 prime. I added some more objects here. It will be soon clear why. Simply what I added here is again exact term, so after integration it will be just boundary time, which will vanish due to our assumption on the variation vanishing to the first order at endpoints. Why I added this here, it's simply so in the conformally flat case, let us focus, and what I will focus since now is the conformally flat case to understand the critical curves. So we have z. The tractor Z has zero in the top slot and the variational vector field Z in the bottom slot. This tractor field has zero in the top slot too. That's why we added these two terms. There is some short computation behind that, but the advantage of this tractor is that it has zero top slot. And if we want this to vanish for every variational vector field, it simply means that this tractor must that the middle slot of this tractor must vanish. In the other words, if we take this tractor plus something t has something only in the bottom slot, it must be zero for some function t. So this is Euler-Lagrange equation for critical curves in the flat case. One can easily compute that phi is actually built from b and alpha. That's an easy thing to do. So now we would like to analyze this equation in more detailed way. Recall that we have some conformal curvatures kappa one, kappa two, or conformal curvature, conformal torsion, depending on the terminology. What this equation means? It means that the third derivative is linear combination of the previous derived the tractors. Now, first, if the second derivative is linear combination of previous ones, it means that it's a conformal circle. It's just a different formulation of the condition for conformal circles. And if the third derivative is linear combination of the previous ones, it means that the second conformal curvature and all higher curvatures must vanish. So this is the first information, and actually one can play with this equation a little bit more. It's rather straightforward using various tricks with tractors to show that actually this equation implies that alpha is constant, this phi is also constant, which means that the first conformal curvature, which is built from this alpha and phi, if we go into details, is also constant. So the conclusion is that on locally flat manifolds, critical curves of this functional are exactly curves which have first conformal curvature constant and all higher conformal curvatures zero. And now we can simply go to the literature. and it's an article of Sharpe and others, where they describe curves with constant conformal curvature and zero conformal torsion and higher ones, and they compute that these are exactly loxodromas. Well, loxodromas in some more general sense include circles and lines. So critical curves are just loxodromas. Fine. This slide is a bit. In this slide, there will be nothing new to what I have written here. It's a reformulation, which I guess is useful and at least should be, and at least it provides a relation to original Fialkov work, which is yeah, as I said, it's often cited, but not really used what Fialkov is doing there. I make some observation. If we have, so we have the tractor fields TU, U prime, and so on. If we want orthonormalize them, then at some stage we need to observe that this tractor is perpendicular to this subbundle, which in particular means that it must have zero top slot. I will denote the middle slot by N. And now if we go back to Fialkov, this N what appears here is, well, I call it here Fialkov normal. Fialkov calls it, I guess, principal normal or first principal normal. It's of course of higher order than we are used in the Riemannian, in the Euclidean geometry. In the Euclidean geometry, the normal is given by the acceleration. Here it is given by the second derivative, so by the jerk. But it's conformally invariant expression. I guess it's exactly the vector field E in Wojciech's talk. Up to the weight, this N is weighted. And this, in Wojciech's talk, this E was unweighted. So it differs by this length of the vector U to minus one or something like that. And in if we use the terminology of Fialkov normal, we can recover the objects we talked about so far. The equation for conformal circles is that Fialkov normal is zero. The condition for conformal arc length is that the Fialkov normal is normalized by reparametrization such that it has the length one. N is density valued, so the length is really a function, not not density. And the equation for loxodromas is that if we differentiate this Fialkov normal along the curve, then it's proportional to U, to the tangent vector. This is conformally invariant condition. That's easy to show. Yeah, and for loxodromas we need this alpha to be constant. Okay, the second variation. We shall continue in the flat case. So now it will be the flat case only. Go back. We ended up with this condition where we finally observed that alpha is constant, so this term will go, and what remains is this equation for critical curves, where phi is non-negative, alpha beta constants. If we compute the second variation at such curve, then now it's just integration by parts, straightforward computation, that the second variation looks like this. This alpha and phi are constant, so this function, these are constants. So that's easy, but actually, is there any chance for local extremals? A priori not, because if this functional alpha depends on the reparametrization. So if we reparametrize, we can easily increase or decrease. And if we take the variational vector field tangent to the curve, it just gives rise to reparametrization. So if we consider such reparametrization, there is no chance for local extremals. But the reasonable question to ask is what happens if we restrict to normal variation only? Because then the reparametrization is excluded. So yeah, so it's question what happens. Of course, the second normal variation cannot be definite for circles, because if we have a circle and try to deform the circle into another circle in the same plane, we can perform it in such a way that we don't change alpha. So the second variation will be zero. So it cannot be really definite. So that's one observation. Now, for simplicity, I will work in dimension three. In the rest, in the last slide, last but one slide. So, in the if the dimension of the manifold is three, the dimension of the tractor bundle is five. So we there is a subbundle generated by first three tractors. Then we have the Fialkov normal, and then we have another tractor which will be actually a constant along the curve, simply because the torsion is zero. It indicates that the torsion is the conformal torsion is zero. So if we want normal variation, this variational tractor field must be linear combination of this guy and this guy. So F and H are some functions. This is the variational tractor field. Actually, this variational tractor field should, I mean, the middle slot of that should vanish at endpoints to the first order, which means that there will be some restriction to F and H. I will come to that in a second. So if we take this expression, substitute this specific form of Z into that, compute for a while, we come to this form of second variation. It's not a priori clear whether it's positive or negative, because yeah, F and H are sort of arbitrary functions modulo its values on endpoints. But what we can use is the Wirtinger's inequality, which tells us that if we have a function on some interval which vanishes at endpoints, that the integral of H prime squared is greater or equal than h integral of h prime, and there is some constant here. And of course, if the interval is short enough, this so the denominator is getting smaller and smaller, so this constant can be as big as we want if we shorten the interval sufficiently. And this simply means that, well, this is for the first derivative here. We can use it for the second derivative as well, which simply means that the value of the H2 prime square is just bigger than this if we restrict to interval short enough. So if this phi is positive, phi is always non-negative. So if this phi is positive, which is true for loxodromas, then this second variation will be always greater than zero. So loxodromas will be local minima of this functional if the interval is short enough. This is not true for conformal circles because for them phi is zero, so this can be easily zero. Then I have one more slide, the last slide with final comments. So the final comments won't go into more details here. It will be comment about other geometry or a bit different situation. Of course, the natural question is if we know how to do something in conformal geometry, what's the CR or projective or whatever analog? The CR situation is particularly interesting. I mean, we have the tractor bundle, we have all the machinery, which is getting more technical in that case, but we have it. It turns out, well, in the CR case, we have two class of curves, transversal and tangent to the distribution. The transversal case is particularly interesting because we have chains there. It turns out that if we take transversal curves and try to find the simplest non-trivial functional using tractors, we shall indeed find some analog of alpha, which transforms via Schwarzian, so it has the same properties or very similar properties as here. And it has some family of critical curves, which includes chains, but it's bigger than chains. What is remarkable here that chains are actually variational. There is a functional which is not built in tractors, built in completely different way. This is the article Chains in CR Geometry as Geodesics of Propina Metrics by Chain Marugamem Matvejev Montgomery. And it's really unclear to me whether this can be built from tractors or not, or how is it related. It's certainly something, the natural analog of alpha, which we had here in the CR case is just, it's not the simplest functional. I mean, there is something what presumably cannot be obtained from tractors or can be, but in some way, which is hidden to me. So this is one observation. And the final thing is, well, I will go back to the dimension three and the Euclidean setting. So after the whole story about the conformal geometry and tractors and so on, we shall go back to some extremely elementary. If we are the three-dimensional case and take the functional given by the torsion in the arc length parameter, this is Euclidean arc length, what will be critical curves? Does anybody know? It's extremely, actually, when I came to this question, I was surprised that I don't know it, and nobody I asked didn't know it. These are exactly circles, surprisingly. Not lines, not conformal circles, just circles. As you can see in the title of the article where it was observed, we are going back to biology inevitably. I don't really know why these are circles. It doesn't work in higher or lower dimensions. Or at least I don't know whether there is an analogy of this phenomenon in dimension four, or what should be the analog. Probably there is no one, I don't know. I would be grateful to understand this case, this more, or whether there is some reason or just by chance. Anyway, thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Josef. Question?
I've got a question at the very end. So I remember that in the CR geometry, the transversal distinguished curves, the standard ones, there are two classes of them. One of them is chains, which have got the projective parametrization, and the other one are these strange ones, which have got naturally affine parametrization only. So does it make some link to your class of the variational ones?
I'm aware of that. I didn't identify them in practice, but we looked at the CR case just very informally, look at the what just appears in tractors, not really computing it, but which orders are here. So we didn't do really much effort in the CR case so far. But I didn't observe that yet. It must be there, and it must somehow appear in the tractor computation. I agree, but so I don't know at the moment.
Other questions? How larger is this class that you mentioned?
You mean the variation?
No. The class that you said you have this Lagrangian tractors, like because
it's 1 degree. The equation is 1 degree higher.
I see. Okay. If from Zoom, there's no one to ask question. So if not, then let's thank Josef again. And we'll continue in the afternoon.
It was a nice talk, Josef.
Thanks.